Good evening and welcome to the CPP Foundation Day lecture. I'm happy to introduce our guest today, K.K. Shailaja, Honorable Former Minister of Health from the Government of Kerala. I'll give a small background about the Center for Public Policy and introduce Madam Shailaja, and then Hrishikesh Krishnan, our director, welcome. The Center for Public Policy was established within the larger Indian Institute of Management, Bangalore umbrella on the 10th of July 2000 through an MOU with the Government of India, UNDP, and the Government of Karnataka. We are a small think tank, set of faculty members within the institute. We work on diverse settings. A large number of our faculty work on health, financial inclusion, infrastructure, law, regulation, poverty, gender, education, urban governance, environment, and the works. We do research, we do teaching, we do training, we do consulting, we do advisory. We do work in partnership with governments. We are on committees. When we decided to have this year's Foundation Day lecture, we have been having this for the last 3 years. First year was the lecture was delivered by Stephen Wilkerson. Last year, the lecture was delivered by Tridik Sukrut, noted Gandhian scholar. And this year, when we were looking for, planning to invite, the overwhelming choice of the department was to invite Shailaja teacher. So we are very happy that she has kindly agreed to come. A brief introduction of Shailaja. She is the former Minister of Health, Social Justice, Women and Child Development, Government of Kerala. She is currently the MLA and Chief Whip of the Communist Party of India Marxist. She's won several awards, including the Janani Award for Integrated Health and Well-being from the Integrated Health and Well-being Council. She also got the Central European University Award from the Open Society Prize for 2021. She's a member of the CPIM Central Committee, as well as Secretary of All India Democratic Women's Association. Thanks a lot, Madam, for coming. I now hand over the dais to Professor Rishi Krishnan to welcome Madam Shailaja.
First of all, let me welcome all of you to this anniversary celebration of the Center for Public Policy at IIM Bangalore. CPP has done very pathbreaking work in all the areas that Professor Sriram mentioned over the last 20 plus years. And we are very fortunate and proud to have the CPP as an integral part of the IIMB family. Of course, IIM Bangalore has a long history and tradition of working on public policy and public services. This goes back to the founding of the institute almost 50 years ago, actually 48 years ago to be precise, when our initial focus was on public sector and public systems. We had, in fact, a sectoral structure of the institute as well for many years, till we transformed the institute into the more traditional structure of functional departments and so on. So in short, IIMB has a long tradition of working on public policy and public systems. And I'm really happy to see that our colleagues in the Center for Public Policy are carrying forward that tradition in a very effective way. So it's, of course, always good to celebrate the progress made by the center. And this Foundation Day is an excellent opportunity to do so. So let me welcome all of you who are attending this event online. And of course, a special welcome to our speaker of today, Shailaja teacher from Kerala. Ma'am has been in the news ever since the pandemic came. At least in Kerala, I'm sure she was in the news even before that. But for people like us in outside Kerala, she has been in the news for the excellent way in which Kerala was able to cope with the COVID pandemic over the last 15 months or so. So it is indeed a great privilege for us to have her speaking to us on this Foundation Day. We, of course, do our study of public policy and public systems largely from an academic perspective, using rigorous research methods and coming to very sort of defendable conclusions. But there is also a very important part of public policy and public systems, which comes from people on the ground who are doing excellent work in managing the complexity involved with these systems. And Shailaja teacher has shown us that It's possible to manage that complexity very well, even in the very challenging circumstances of a pandemic that we have seen in the last 15 to 16 months. So, ma'am, on behalf of the Institute, I welcome you once again. Thank you for accepting our invitation, and we are eagerly looking forward to listen to you. Thank you.
Good evening to all. Respected Dr. Professor Sriram and all the dignitaries who are participating in this webinar, my dear brothers and sisters and dear students. First of all, I want to express my thanks for inviting me to deliver the third Foundation Day lecture of CPP. And also, this time I want to appreciate Professor Sriram for helping Kerala to formulate a document on formation of the Kerala Bank. I think that is a very good initiative, and also that report became a milestone in the cooperative sector and several other. We formed the Kerala Bank depending upon this statement or this report, expert committee report. And some other states are also now thinking to form their own banks, cooperative banks in their states. And that is a very good step towards the cooperative sector. And I want to congratulate and I want to express our thanks to Professor Sriram and who worked with them, with him to formulate that report. And today, you asked me to speak about the management of COVID-19 pandemic and the situation of our state during the pandemic season, and also for the what we are doing for the future plan. And you give me some points to discuss about. I think one is the how we are managing the emergency thing to respond to the virus, and what is our existing policy framework on that, and also what is the dealings with the central government during this pandemic season, and also how we are managing the resource allocation, and what is the dynamics with the cabinet, and also the command and control mechanism with bureaucracy, how we operate it, and also the coordination activities, cross-cutting ministries and departments, and also learnings from the pandemic for the future or for the normal times. Such points we want to discuss during this webinar. And first of all, I want to get your attention to Kerala, that Kerala's society or Kerala's development model traces back to its historical advancement in human development. I think from 1957 onwards, we are implementing some humanitarian approach and also people-centered method and people's planning for the development. Before 1957, I think you all of you know that after independence, we were trying to inculcate a people-centered system of governance here. Before that, feudalism is rampant in Kerala also, like other states of India. It is rampant here also. The system was here. And also, as we are looking that the consumerist culture, because of the capitalist mode of ruling, that also is coming at that time. And the dual culture, the one side the feudalist approach and the other part the consumerist culture, profit-oriented method, and both of them have some demerits or some drawbacks in the part of, if we are thinking in the part of the poor people, the toiling people in village and even in the cities. And that when 1957, a left government was in power in Kerala during that, when we formed the linguistic states, the first election was conducted in 1957. And a government came in power, a democratic government came in power at that time. And that government took some important decision in the legislature, passed some acts in the legislature One is to stop the eviction of the poor people, poor peasants and agricultural workers from their land by the landlords. We stopped that thing. Another thing was the reformation, a very good start for the education reformation. And also other thing is in the reform in the part of public health system. And that was a basement or basic structure. And after that, several governments continued this kind of people-centered activities in Kerala. And over the year, we are able to build a very good public health system, very good public education system, and also a people's planning in the governance. And that helped us very much during this pandemic season also. Actually, the COVID-19 pandemic became a litmus test to the governance system throughout the world. This pandemic was it is spreading in each and every countries, and different countries took different methods to contain the virus or struggle with the virus. And the systems of the governance are being discussed during these 1.5 years. And Kerala, if anyone is saying anything, is model in Kerala. We are not saying like that. Everyone have different methods, and we have to find out which method is fruitful and which method is good. And I think there is no method complete is 100% perfect to combat with the highly spreading virus. But we can explain some methods we adopted during this pandemic season. That is why I am saying that the achievements of Kerala, we have to look in the history of Kerala and the development of these people-centered policy and the actions throughout these years. And the concept of welfare state spearheads the socio-economic development plans of Kerala. And these welfare policies were part of Kerala's humane and inclusive response to the COVID-19 pandemic also. And Kerala, I think Kerala has one of the long-drawn pandemic. The pandemic appeared in Kerala, reported in Kerala in the late January 30th, 2020, and just after the Wuhan incidents. And when we heard about a potential virus is spreading in Wuhan, China, at once we acted on that. I was the health minister at that time. And when I happened to read some article in some publication that a potential virus, that virus belonging to the coronavirus family, that is SARS coronavirus 2, is spreading in Wuhan, and it is highly infectious and highly spreading virus. And I feel some fear in my heart because I have the experience of Nipah virus at that time. Nipah appeared in 2018 in a village in Calicut district of Kerala. And at that time, we were not aware of the Nipah virus, but it appeared there. And it's not important, it appeared in Kerala. From bats, it transmitted to the human being. Bats are the natural carriers of the Nipah virus. A peculiar disease happened to occur in one family, and the four family members showed severe symptoms like fever, cough, and everything. And we admitted them to the hospital, and we tried to understand what is the cause of their infection. And we find out from the laboratory virology lab in Mangalore, we came to know that it is Nipah virus. And when I heard about Nipah, I searched in Google to find out what is Nipah and what is its behavior. I was astonished that it was a newly emerging zoonosis, and there is no proper vaccination for prevention and no proper medicine for it. And it is highly, its mortality rate is very high and infectious also. But I have no time to fear or to hesitate to plan an action on that. I was the health minister. I have to do that. And just at that time, I called my health secretary and discussed with him. And we opened the control room in Calicut. And I moved to Calicut and I stayed there. And we opened a control room there. And I stayed Calicut for 1 month during the containment of Nipah virus, and we started everything. From that, we learned a lesson that if an infectious disease occurs in any place, the first thing we have to do is to close that area. And that that idea came from that experience. Because when we reported that, when we came to know that it is Nipah virus, it is published through newspapers, and the people in that village, in Changaroth village of Calicut district, the media men said, told me that the people from Changaroth village is started to evacuate from there, and they are flying to other places, and they are afraid of the virus, and they are going out to other villages and other districts. I really afraid of that, because if anyone is a carrier of that virus, they will go to other village and the virus will transmit to there also. And we have to open more war field instead of one. And that is the reasonable, due to that reasonable thing, I took decision at once. I asked my officials to just, we want to go there and to stop their movement from that place to other place. And the officials didn't agree that I should not go there, because I'm the leader, and if I got the virus, everything will finish. But I said that I am a elective representative of the people, and they will stop only if the elective representative appeal them to stay there. And I rushed there and I asked the people to stay there, and we closed that area. Closing means not abandoning the people in that village. Closing means we have to supply everything there. And I called a meeting with the chief minister, insisted us to do anything and everything what is necessary there. He said that don't think about money or anything. We will supply, we will give more money to you for the action, and act well for that. And I called upon a meeting of other stakeholders and other departments, and we worked together. We formed a team. Team formation is the first part to doing or to fighting against this kind of difficulties. And we formed a team. And that was a very good experience. We pulled everything in that village, supplied everything, medicine, and also the essential food and all other essential items, and field work also arranged. Our accredited social health activists, ASHA workers and junior PHNs and HIS health inspectors visited each and every home and examined whether they are in need of anything. And that way we acted, and each and every symptomatic cases we admitted the hospital and isolated them and treated them well. And that way we contained that virus within a short span of time and within that limit of area. In that village. And that was a very good experience. And from that, we studied about the quarantine, isolation, testing, tracing, etc. And when I heard about this COVID-19 virus, I felt something like Nipah virus incidents. And I asked my health secretary to call at once to form the rapid response team and also the control room and everything. We have formed 18 expert groups and give responsibility to additional health directors to each and every team. One is responsible for collection of the personal protection equipments, and other is for the isolation, and other is for quarantine and contact tracing, etc. And collection of medicines. Everything, we formed 18 expert teams in the center, state center. And also we formed a district control room also within 2 days. At that time, no one returned from Wuhan to Kerala. We anticipated that they will return. And as we anticipated, on January 27th, 2020, a flight came from Wuhan. I think almost 72 passengers were in it from Wuhan. And we screened that passengers in the airport itself, and we trained some team, and we put them in the airport, and they screened, and we got 3 cases and 3 positive cases. First positive case was reported on January 30th, and February 2nd and 3rd two more cases reported. That was the starting stage. And because of our pre-preparedness and timely action, no spread was occurred at that time from the three patients, and they cured and left the hospital in proper time. After 2 weeks, nothing happened here. And someone advised me that please withdraw your team from the airport. They are standing there with a gun. They have the temperature searching. They think that it is a gun. Some poor people said that standing there with a gun, why are you overacting? And please withdraw your team. But with the experience of other infectious disease, I said that it is not time to withdraw that team. The people may go to other countries also from Wuhan, and this virus is highly infectious. And from other countries, people will return to Kerala who may be carrier of this virus. And we put our team in airport constantly, and they stayed there. And as we anticipated, some people returned from Italy, from UK, from USA, and from them also, we caught the COVID-19 virus at that time. And we started our strategy, action, etc. At that time, Kerala was the first team, and we have to formulate the standard protocols and also the SOPs, standard operating procedures. Also, we have to set it. We cannot rely on other states because there was no COVID in other states at that time. And we depend ourselves, and we find out the things from the literature and also from other countries, and we listen to everywhere, and the WHO statements, etc. And we discussed with the experts, and we formulate our standard operating procedures and also very good protocols. The experience with the Nipah also helped us to formulate a SOP and a protocol. And that was very good, very working, and also very practical. And we started our work ourselves at that time. When the virus occurred in other states, that states asked us, please send your protocols and SOPs for us also. We are also starting our action. And central government itself, central health ministry also asked us to send our protocols and procedures to them also. And we send that thing to them also. And we started our work. The key thing is that it is the collective work and handpicking the experts in the committees, and to arrange each and everything in district level also, to monitor them and give them advice and take the experience from them. And that was the method. We adopted some strategy to contain the virus, to control the spreading. We adopted some strategy. First strategy is to taking a method that tracing is the first thing, to trace everybody who are coming back from other countries, maybe carriers of virus. Trace, quarantine, test, isolate, and treat. At that time, WHO and other parties saying that test, nothing else. And that is a good thing. The test is the most important part. But we took the strategy that trace, quarantine, test, isolate, and treat. We traced everyone, and we quarantined every expatriate who came back from other countries. And also we tested the symptomatic cases, and also we quarantined them for 28 days. The first part we quarantined them because of this fear, we quarantined them for 28 days properly. And if any symptoms occurred, we usually to test them and isolate them properly if they are tested positive. And we followed that strategy, and that was a very good strategy. And also the contact tracing. We adopted several methods using even artificial intelligence and IT, everything to trace the contact. We published the route map of the passengers without revealing the names. Who came from where and go there and sit there like that, and ask the people whether they have any contact with these places, please report to us. And they very good report we got from the public, and that way we traced each and every contact in the first part. And at that time, March 24th, central government declared lockdown. That was a blessing. At that time, we are able to advance the health system or strengthen the health system. During that time, we got a breathing time at that time. And up to May 3rd, the lockdown was there, and we acted well during that time. Our intention is to put the potential of the virus below the health system resilience threshold. And we started working. We started to implement more beds or arranging more beds in the hospital, in the government hospitals like medical colleges, hospitals, and also secondary level hospitals like district and taluk hospitals. And we purchased more ventilators and also ICU units, etc. And we arranged everything. And we even started the production of oxygen even in the first stage. We anticipated that in future, we will face the scarcity of oxygen, and we started to have enough oxygen. And we purchased enough personal protection equipments also through our medical service corporation. And we started every work, everything at that time. And our intention is to keep the health system potential to tackle the problem properly. And also another strategy was to control the spreading. And we announced a campaign called Break the Chain at that time, to break the chain of the spreading of the transmission. And we started SMS campaign intermediate time. We started SMS campaign called means the S for soap or sanitizer, and M for mask, and the last S for the social distance. And we used the celebrities and school children and everyone to propagate the idea to keep 2 meter distance from others if you are suspecting them for COVID, and wear mask properly and use sanitizer. Even within 20 or 30 minutes, you have to use the sanitizers. And that way, we tried to contain or stop the spreading of the virus. That was our strategy. And while we are adopting the strategy, we have to face some challenges also. And as you know, Kerala is in the forefront when we compare to other states for some health indices. The child mortality rate, it is too low in Kerala. It is, I think it can be compared to high development countries and developed countries. And also the maternal mortality rate, that is also too low. And that kind of thing. And the old age population, that is the life expectancy, is high in Kerala. These are very good things, and we have first place out of that. But we have some wrong first place also in Kerala, because during this development, I think you know that in human development index also Kerala is in the forefront. Per capita income also increased in Kerala during these years. But we have some wrong things also, that is we can say that there are some threats. These threats are some of them are demographic and others are epidemiological. The demographic challenges we faced or we are facing during this pandemic is, one is our population density. And Kerala's population density is 860 within 1 square kilometer. And our country's population density is only 430. Then you can understand what is the population density in Kerala. That is a great challenge during the highly infectious virus. And also other demographic difficulty is that we cannot say that a difficulty, that's a positive thing. But during the pandemic season, it also became a challenge. That is the old age population. And our old age population percentage is 15% out of the total population. Because of the high life expectancy, that's a good thing. But during the pandemic, that is a great challenge to protect the old ages from the virus. And we adopted a reverse quarantine system to protect the poor and old age people from the pandemic. And we didn't allow them to go outside their home, but we used some counselors and our field level workers to interact with them, because they become frustrated because of the containment or because of the because we are insisting them to stay there, don't move, don't go outside, etc. But our counselors and our Anganwadi workers and our ASHA workers called them morning and evening and inquired what is happening there and is there any need to them, any medicine, any lifestyle disease medicine or anything they want. We were supplying that thing in their home. And that reverse quarantine also helped in the first part very much to contain this thing, to reduce the spread at that time. And the epidemiological vulnerability we are facing is nothing but the lifestyle diseases, non-communicable diseases. It is rampant in Kerala. And not only one thing, more a large number of diseases like this diabetes and hypertension, cancer, thyroid, everything is rampant here because of the changed lifestyle. As you know, we changed our lifestyle and also our behavior. We are not doing proper exercises, physical exercises, but eating more rice and nothing else. And we are not getting proper thing from our food to get immunity. And because of that, the people are attacked by these things, these non-communicable diseases or lifestyle diseases. That is a dangerous thing during the cruel pandemic. And if any person caught this virus, if they have comorbidities, they are started to succumb to death. And that frightened us. And at once we acted and we supplied, we make it sure that the NCD medicines are reaching in their home. We started that thing previously, not only during the pandemic season, but also we had started a mission in health sector called Ardram Mission. And through Ardram Mission, we were trying to improve the public health system throughout the 5 years. And that helped us very much during the pandemic season also. And during this pandemic season, we got some good things from the Ardram Mission. The slogan of the Ardram Mission is to make the government hospitals, public health system, people's friendly and also technologically advanced, and to reduce the out-of-pocket expenditure. When I got the charge of health minister in 2016, and that government came to power at that time, when I was dealing with the health minister, I want to study what is happening in the health system in Kerala and studied with the help of the experts. And I found that, I astonished that more than 60%, correctly saying, 67% of the population in Kerala was depending private sector for the treatment at that time in 2016. Only 33% are coming, percentage is coming, was coming to the public system. And I inquired why it is happening like this. 50% of the population in Kerala are not highly rich. They want to get free treatment and free education, etc. Then why people are going to spend their money for treatment? And I found that our primary health system was not proper. It is comparatively, it is good. Each and every panchayat, we have a primary health center. But that primary health center was functioning only up to noontime. And only one doctor was there at that time. No proper laboratories to test sugar or pressure, anything. And at once we formed some projects for Ardham Mission, a very good project. And in that we included the prevention and primary care more than anything. We give importance to prevention and primary care. And we converted, we are converting the PHC, primary health center, to family health centers. The infrastructure we are changing, very good infrastructure. Now there is a very good garden in front of the primary health center and very good reception inside with airport model chairs are put there and very good infrastructure, very good consulting room, observation room, that is high tech. All the, even the cords are also high tech thing, not the previously, the old fashioned thing, and also very good immunization center and even a yoga center. And some clinics are started there in primary sector itself. That is COPD clinics. We called Schwas clinic. and also to testing the chronic obstructive pulmonary diseases, even in the primary stage, even in the grassroots level. And also we started Ashwas clinics to test the depression, the mental disorders, etc. previously, the early detection. It is meant for early detection, not for treatment. And we detect anything serious, we will send them or refer them to the higher hospitals. We converted the secondary level hospitals also. The money is the scarcity for doing this kind of things, advancements. And as you know, our country is spending only 1% of GDP in the health sector to invest in the public sector. And we are getting that share only. And with the plan fund, the routine plan fund, we cannot do any magic in the primary health center or public sector. But we are lucky that the previous government, where I was the health minister, the honorable chief minister and finance minister started the KIFBI project, Kerala Infrastructure Investment Fund Board. And we also got some soft loans from the government. We are not taking loans. Government is taking loans through KIFBI. And the government decided to invest some money in the capital sector, capital expenditure. I think the cleverness of government, any government, is that to invest money in the for the capital expenditure. That will do good in future. And we also got more than 3,000 crores or rupees in health sector to invest only in capital sector to improve the infrastructure and to buy some new equipments for that we utilize that thing. And our taluk level hospitals are changing. It's I think anyone can look at it and the magic is happening in Kerala that the taluk level hospitals are transforming to high technology institutions with modular labs and also the OP sector, people's friendly, and technology is adopted, high technology is adopted to change that things. And we transferred the super speciality to district hospitals bravely. Someone threatened us, me, that if you are transferring this, transforming this thing, the cath labs and also for stroke units, etc. in district sector, you will suffer and you didn't get, you cannot get the cardiologists or nephrologists or neurologists to the district level. Then I think we should have to act without fear, and that will succeed. And we started, our department started to give cath labs or cardiology unit to district level hospital. I am not explaining everything. It is a fantastic work, and we had done a fantastic job during these 5 years. That is why the hospitals, public hospitals, get equipped with new equipments and also new wards and new cots and new ICUs, etc. That also helped us to fight against the COVID-19 pandemic. And we should learn one lesson, or we must learn a lesson from the pandemic, that the, throughout the globe, we should have to invest in public health sector, invest more money. And some countries are investing more than 10%, more than 15%, etc. The investing for the sake of investing, that is nothing, that will do nothing good. But we should have to ensure the participation of people and people-centered method and inclusive growth. And we should have to equal participation or give equal opportunity to the people. The democracy, we are always saying about the democracy, what is the democratic way? Our country got independence in the year 1947. After that, we are every time we are talking about this democracy, and we should think, what is democracy? Democracy doesn't mean the term accommodation of Tom or Harry to the office. The Greek philosophers said like that. Democracy doesn't mean the accommodation of Tom or Harry to the office. It means perfect equality and opportunity. We should have to examine whether the poor villages are getting proper opportunity, whether they are getting a good hospital for the treatment, whether they are getting a good school for their education. Throughout the country, we should have to examine. But Kerala, we had done a far better thing. We have very, very good schools in our villages and very good hospitals. And We tried to improve that during the last 5 years to tackle this kind of problems. That is our strategy, and we are doing that thing nowadays also. And very good health, functional health planning and administration. That is why we were able to stop the virus or contain the virus in the first phase. And when the central government lifted the lockdown in May 3rd, at that time, Kerala was a safe zone. We stopped the spreading. We flattened the curve to the zero level. And Kerala felt a safe zone. At that time, the BBC, Guardian, every these publications and channels, etc., called me because I was the health minister at that time and asked, how can you control this thing? You know, the whole other part of the globe, it is spreading. It was spreading at that time. And I said that it is nothing but the collective work. My team, my very good team, health team, we handpicked eminent personality to the leadership and we activated the whole system, even from the higher officials to the grassroots level, field level workers. And we are giving continuous training and we are conducting continuous meeting for evaluation and we are inspiring them also. I think we can inculcate a we feeling among them. We are fighting together. We are fighting an invisible enemy. We cannot see the enemy in front of us. We are fighting with an invisible enemy and we have to be cautious about that. And we have to sacrifice our energy for our nation and for our poor people or for the whole society. It is our duty. And my team worked hard. Day and night they worked hard and we have very good result. But when the lockdown was lifted, the Chennai was the hotspot at that time and Mumbai was the hotspot at that time and Bangalore was the hotspot at that time and all the Malayalis tried to come back. They have a cry in their places and they send letters to our government and they want to come back. Kerala is safe. We are coming back. We cannot deny that thing. But we allowed them to come back because the interstate travel restriction was lifted by the central government. We cannot put them under pressure anywhere. And we welcomed them to Kerala. But we put our team in the road and even when they are coming by water, we put our team for tracing. There also in the airport, seaport and the road, check post, etc. And we tried to find out. But some people obeyed that and some people came to Kerala through the village pass, etc. without a notice or nighttime also. We are not accusing. They are frightened. They were frightened at that time. And they some clusters occurred in Kerala at that time. And at once, we arranged a cluster management strategy. With the help of experts, we formulated a cluster management strategy. The same strategy in the Nipah period. We closed that cluster and we supplied everything inside the cluster and don't allow people to move outside from the cluster. And we contained these clusters also in a successful manner. And at that time, the first wave occurred in Kerala. And the people predicted that during the first wave, more than 30,000 cases will report per day. And we worked hard for that. Every time we were giving these things to the people also, to the population also, we are communicating this thing. And we started the cluster management strategy and we tried our best to contain that. Same time, break the chain, reverse quarantine and tracing everything. And we got a very good result out of that also. In the first wave, we were able to delay the peak. Our slogan at that time is to delay the peak. If the peak occur all of a sudden, the health system will have to compromise to the virus. But we have to put the virus under the health system resilience threshold. And we won that can reduce that thing. And also, again, we flattened the curve and to the below 1,000 per day. And that is going down. At that time, the local body election also conducted during that time. And when the first wave is diminished and it become flattened, at that time, the second thing started that the assembly elections declared at that time. And the whole government system was dealing with assembly election after April or March, after March itself. After January, February to May, the whole system was dealing with the election, assembly election. And ministers, chief minister, everyone become candidates at that time. And that time, people gathered here and there for the election campaign. We insisted that they should keep the COVID protocol, wear mask and keep distance, but nothing happened. Each and every political party gathered peoples for their election campaign. And at that time, we feared that a second wave will definitely occur. That happened. Not only in Kerala. I think it is not only because of election, but the second wave occurred throughout the world. That is the behavior of the virus. But one thing happened here, that we cannot delay the peak this time. The peak occurred all of a sudden. And that for that, we have to suffer very much. But we tried best to get advanced or to improve our health system. And we arranged more ventilators and more these ICU units, etc. And one thing we can say with enthusiasm that no patient in Kerala have to lie on the roads or without getting oxygen, they died. More people died during the second wave. The first part, the mortality rate is 0.4%, only 0.4%. Sometimes it go below 0.3%, etc. But the average of an average, we can say that 0.4%. And the number of death is also too low at that time. Some people said that you are not reporting most of the death, but it is not true. When I was there, some newspapers reported that with name, some deaths are not reporting. And I examined that and then find out that after the days of their death, they were reported in the portal. And I sent the letter to newspapers also. But there are some kind of discussion that what method we are adopting to include them in the list. We are following the ICMR guidelines and WHO guidelines. If a person become negative, they are not including in the COVID death. But if the central government or ICMR is changing the guideline, we can also change the guideline and we can find out. There is a register in each and every hospital of the COVID positive patients. And when they become negative and whether they are positive during their death, we can examine properly. Because in Kerala, each and every things are in the portal. And we can examine that thing also. But the reporting system is perfect in Kerala. We are also registering each and every death. Death registration is 100% in Kerala. I think in some states only below 50% is the civil death registration. And in Kerala, it is 100% because there are so strong local self-governments and strong wards. They are examining each and every death. I am not extending my speech like this, elaborations. But this is the situation in Kerala. But now the second wave is going on and the test positivity rate is becoming standing as a plateau and deaths are also happening. But yet, if we add every death in the death toll, the mortality rate is below 0.6%. That is below 1%. WHO is saying that if we can keep the fatality rate below 1%, it is a good thing. And we are keeping that mortality rate below 6% now also. And we are working hard to tackle the problem this time also that is happening in Kerala. And the planning and administration, that is the most important thing. And decisive campaigns and taking proper decision at proper time. The leader should be there. That is the most important thing. Leader should be approachable to each and every one. That is the most important thing. I'm not explaining. If you are asking any questions, I can explain about that. And the campaigns and people-centered approach and public trust and to get public trust and cooperation, that is the most important thing. And that is the most important thing. And the future also. For future also, we have to prepare for the future. And what is the future? There are some drawbacks from the COVID-19 pandemics. I think there are some opportunities also. We should have to utilize that opportunities for the future. And there are several opportunities that I can respond to our questions. We are also trying to utilize that opportunities in correct time, for the proper time. And for the future, we have very good plan that people-centered method and even the social businesses and the group activities, etc., and the production and sale in the village also to promote the small-scale industries and some home-based works, etc. There are so many things like that. And huge projects are also there. And at last, I want to appeal. I have an appeal to the young people in the IIM that the youth should come forward to shoulder the responsibilities. They should have to act well. They are the backbone of the society, human race. This is a threat to human race itself, not only in Kerala or India or any part of the world, but it is a threat to the human race. How to save the human race in future? How to fight with this kind of difficult viruses? There are so many viruses here, not only the corona family viruses, but also there are so many viruses. And how can we tackle this problem? Is the vaccination proper? And is the preventive activities are proper? We have to find out and we have to work to prevention, for prevention and control of this kind of difficulties in difficult situations. We have to shoulder the responsibilities ourselves. And the success often goes to those who dare and act. It seldom goes to the timid. Jawaharlal Nehru once said, our first prime minister once said, that is the thing. We have to work hard. We have to struggle with these difficult situations and we can win definitely. And with these few words, I am concluding my speech. Thank you all.
Thank you, ma'am. I think sets of questions that have already started coming in. There are political questions and policy questions. So I will try and focus more on the policy questions than on the political questions. But nevertheless, I think one question which is there on everybody's mind, and I think we should get that out of the way to start with, is that right now Kerala is reporting the highest number of COVID cases. And therefore, there is a one set of questions which asks, how do you still call it a successful model? Is it really a successful model? There are reports that, cases are being, deaths are being hidden and things like that. Would you like to respond to that first? And then I'll get back to a few policy questions.
Yes.
Let's get that out of the way to start.
Thank you, Professor. This is a relevant question, First of all, I want to say there is no 100% successful model in tackling the pandemic throughout the globe. But what is the definition of the success? We have to find out that. I explained this thing in my speech that during second wave, the number of cases increased. I think it is because of one reason. The mingling of the people occurred, that I said. But from the beginning of the first wave, second wave, we have a very good zero surveillance study in Kerala before that. And we found that only 11% of Keralites are infected by the virus because of our quarantine isolation and this break the chain, etc. Our hard work, only 11% of the population got infected by the virus. All the other part, 89% of the population was or is susceptible. Susceptibility is a good thing, but it also is a tension. Even if we are not getting, if we are not getting proper vaccination this time, and the only one method to get mass immunity or herd immunity is to get proper vaccination. Some people are saying let them allow to infect with the virus, and if all the people infected by the virus, we will get herd immunity. We cannot allow that. Kerala didn't allow that policy, that the mitigation method, etc. We used the contain method because if a person get infected with the coronavirus and if he or she get cured from the virus, there are so many problems left, that the post-COVID scenario, post-COVID symptoms and the difficulties they are facing. And the scientists are studying about that. So our intention was to protect the people from the infection, to prevent the infection. And we succeeded in the first part. And the second part, during the second wave, we didn't get proper vaccination. And community spread occurred that time. Throughout the world, community spread occurred. And if we are able to get a proper vaccination, proper amount of vaccination, we are sure that we will contain this thing this time also. We are ready to vaccinate everyone. Our system is prepared for that. Even in the primary health center, we are ready to give vaccination. We trained the staff in the primary health center also, but we are not getting proper vaccination. In India, we are not getting proper vaccination in any place. When we applied for 1.5 crores, we are getting on 2 lakhs or 3 lakhs like that. And that is not sufficient. That is why during the time the spread occurred, and also because of the mutant variant, etc., the death also increased. But the death rate, it is not increasing alarmingly. We are containing that thing. This time also, we are working hard to slow down, to flatten the curve. And it flattened somewhat. And from daily cases of 40,000 like that, it showed a downward trend to 10,000 like that. And but it is a plateau, and we should have to work hard. And it is not a, I think we are not a failure. We are not a failure. We cannot say so. But 100% success, I think the no places of the world showed 100% success. If there is any good method in any part of the world, we can take that method, you know. We are trying to find out that thing.
Thank you, ma'am. There was one more question about demographics. I think you addressed that question in your itself. So I'll pass that. There are two other questions. One is, you've taken a loan and you've invested in healthcare facilities. 3,000 crores is what you had mentioned. Professor Arnab Mukherjee has this question. How do you plan to repay that? It's nice that you've invested it, but is there a revenue model that can help you to repay that? Would you like to take that question?
Yeah. If we are getting proper amount of money from central government or any government, there is no need to take loans. Even central government is also adopting this method of taking loans and spending for the urgent needs and purposes. And all the state governments and central governments are under debt out of that. And I think taking loans and spending properly and managing it properly is not a bad thing. And it is the only method. It is only choice in front of the governments. Our state is not, Kerala is not a well-built state or a financially fit state. And we have no revenue income other than the plan fund given by the state, central government. And we are, ours is the federal system, and central government is the union of state governments, and all the taxes are going to center, and center is giving share in each and every year, and every 5 year, 5 year for the 5 year plan or yearly plan, they are giving the plan fund for us. It is not sufficient, and we cannot do anything with the share of 1% of expenditure in the health sector. And it is a mere thing we can say, a meager amount we can say, we are not sufficient from that. That is why we are thinking to take some loans or that kind of thing. This Kerala Infrastructure Investment Fund Board, it is a good start, and it helped to improve the infrastructure in agriculture sector, in the water supply sector and irrigation sector, and also in the education sector. The all the public schools are become a high-tech schools now, and people from private sector return to public sector. More than 50% students are now studying in public sector, and that will save the expenditure of the family or save the budget of the family. And on that way, there are some movement of money or there are some good response of money in the market also. And that way we are motivating these things or the action in the market and other place. That means that is a good society, expanding or working society. And KIFBI, Kerala Infrastructure Investment Fund Board, is collecting some money through this kind of loans from other agencies, and with a small interest, and with I think it's a long-term loan, and we should have it to remit that money in long term. If we are investing that thing to the hospital building and also school building, etc., we can save some expenditure in the transport vehicle tax, etc., and we are remitting that money. We can from that that revenue income, and we calculated that. But the thing is that we are getting huge amount of money and we are building it urgently. And throughout the years, when we started one school building and we get 2 crores or 1 crore, and in each and every year and other year we are getting 20 lakhs or 50 lakhs. And how can we finish that thing? How can we finish? How can we build according to our dream? And we should have to give this society and the students and their parents, etc., in their living time, the present time, we should have to give this technologically fit thing and advanced thing to. They have to utilize that. And only one method is that is collecting more money and building as soon as it is possible. And in health sector, my experience is that if we install one instrument and when we examine after 2 years, it becomes old one, and new investigations are going on, and new instruments are coming, accurate things are coming in the scanning, imaging section, etc. It is coming. We have to get that thing, and that will help to prevent the disease, early detection, and the correct detection with these high technology in these instruments. And that is the thing. The government, the poor people can enjoy that thing in their living time. Not only dreams, but also the practical things. Dreams we are giving every time. That no scarcity for that. But we are not giving the practical thing to the people. Now in Kerala, we are giving the practical experience to the poor people. That is the difference.
Our only question is, how do you pay back? You know, because if you're...
Yes, there is this.
Public service and not charging, is there a revenue model through which you were able to pay back? I mean, that was a...
Yeah, Professor, I am not an economist and I cannot explain each and every aspect of that. But I also inquired. I am a citizen. And I also inquired whether we can pay back this thing or not to the finance minister and the experts. I inquired. And they explained to me that thing also, and I was convinced. I cannot explain everything, but from some time, I told you about some taxes from collecting from the motor vehicle tax, etc. And there are some ways, and they be calculated. We are ready to remit that share of tax during these years, you know. That is not difficult.
You need to get Dr. Thomas Isaac once to better idea of this.
You can inquire to Thomas Isaac for that.
So let me ask one more question, which my colleague has asked, which is an interesting question. How did you keep the morale of the staff high even during the second phase? Because it's been a long drawn process, unlike the other pandemics that you've dealt with, the Nipah or anything, which is short duration and quickly contained. That's the question. How do you keep...
Yes, it is the too difficult part, I can say so. During the 1.5 year, we have done so many things for the morale boosting of my staff, and they are feeling the burns of the experiences. You know, they are directly working in the COVID positive wards, wearing the personal protection equipments, and they cannot breathe properly, and they cannot even wipe out their sweat, etc. What a terrible thing they are suffering out of that, and mental torture also. They cannot go to their home freely and cannot see their young ones for days, etc. The doctors, nurses, and all the staffs. And I always I have the fear. I had the fear when I was the health minister, and I used to meet each and everyone. Every day I was conducting meeting, and the higher officials asked me, "Minister, you should come to the each and every meeting and speak to these staff, our staffs." And I give some enthusiasm to them. The first thing is to, as I told earlier, that to inculcate a we feeling in them, and we are fighting, we are in the war front and we are fighting, we are not taking rest. for the poor people, to save the lives, hundreds of lives. We are working hard. We have no time to feel tiredness or like that. I am also working. I was also working with them. I didn't take any day, any single day, I was not out of them. I was visible to them. I am speaking to them. I was speaking to them every time. And also, occasionally, we were also conducting some cultural programs within short time. We were not getting time for that, but I am asking the celebrities to participate in some meetings, and they were also talking with our staff, and they were giving them inspirations. They congratulate the staffs. They feel that they are doing for their nation and their state, etc. And we are talking to each other to release the mental burden and stress. We were talking each and every time. They are permitted to call me directly in my phone at that time. Each DMOs and DPMs and other medical officers, they can call me if they are facing any kind of threats or any feeling. They can call us directly, the higher officials and me. And we were talking to them. And that way, we formed a very good team. That team spirit kept them from exhausting everything. They become energetic, and they were working with the full enthusiasm and with full mindedness. They were working for the society, and that way we were releasing the stress. And the counselors are there also. We are giving counseling to our staffs also, and also for the poor people also. We have more than 2,500 expert counselors. We are utilizing them, and we are utilizing the public from the private sector also. We are pulling some counselors from there also, and we are giving counseling to the depressed and the disturbed patients. And that way we are managing these things.
I have a question from a colleague of mine, Professor Hema Swaminathan. She says, have you considered or used behavioral transforming messaging for COVID protocols, masking, avoiding crowds, etc.? I'll add my own small bit to it. Did you use the election campaign for spreading the positive message of distancing and things like that? You know, it's a contradictory thing that you're gathering crowds for campaigning, but are you using the campaigning for saying that don't crowd?
Yes, that time also we used the election campaign for this thing also. But the one thing happened during the election, the mass gathering, that I think that was not a great problem, because everyone were wearing mask and keeping some distance, and they were not talking. They are only listening to the candidates and leaders. That was not a problem at that time. But one real problem occurred, that is the inner party meetings of each and every parties. They were sitting in a closed room, and they were discussing about their strategies and planning to win the election. Hours and hours of meeting they were conducting, closing the doors and etc. And that place, each and every places, the transmission occurred at that time. I think that is why the virus spread is getting more vigorous at that time. But the public meetings and each and every gatherings, we were giving the message of wearing mask and also using sanitizers, etc. And people were also obeying that thing. And we can use that gatherings also for the propaganda, to teach what is the virus and how is it transmitting from one person to another person, and what is the dangerous thing about the virus, that we are able to teach them. But these closed meetings and near contact, that made some difficulties during that time.
So two of my colleagues have similar questions on the overall healthcare system in India. And you've talked about the healthcare system. What is it that we can do to ensure that there is sufficient public investment in healthcare in India, right from primary all the way up? And what is your message to the rest of the country?
Professor, you are asking about the oral
health. Rest of the country, the healthcare outside of Kerala, because you described how it is, but how is it that the other states can also cope up and invest in the healthcare system? Is there a message from your side?
Yes, we should have to invest more money in the public health system. Private sector should be there. I am not denying the activities of the public private health system, And they also cooperated us in tackling the containment of this virus throughout these 1.5 years. But for the 50% of the people, we should have to improve the public health system. We should have to invest more in public health. Central government should answer to this this thing, that they should invest more than, I think, more than 10% of the GDP in the at least more than 10% of the GDP in the health sector. And they should have to make it sure that each and every village there will be a primary hospital for the poor country people, for village people. And that way we should have to improve the health system throughout India and throughout the world. They should have to invest in public health system. That is the only answer. That is the only way to get out of the difficulties in future.
So one of my colleagues, Arpit Shah, has a question. He says, was it difficult to manage the migrants, and how was that strategy different from residents? That is one. I'll add one more bit, you know, because I was keen that you focus a little bit on center state. For example, when there was a national lockdown, you did not have any, you know, anybody coming inside. At that time, people were, you know, mentioning that we should have a decentralized approach and we should not have a centralized approach. But when the lockdown was lifted, you yourself said that it was a little bit of a problem because all the Malayalis started coming back and you could not go ahead. I mean, is that something to do with decentralized control, centralized control? Is there a state center issue there? And second, migrant, these two questions.
Yes, we cannot blame the central government or anybody because this is a long-drawn pandemic and we cannot kept it close for a long period or forever. We cannot close everything. We should have to lift the thing. But the thing is that we cannot be safe if everybody becomes safe. We cannot end the pandemic. Kerala alone cannot end the pandemic if other states can also end the thing. That is the thing. And throughout the world, it is the thing. We cannot be safe alone. We want to be safe. All part of the world should be safe to get us safe. And that is the reason. And the other thing, I explained that only way to control the infectious disease is to close that place where it occurred. I am not speaking about our country or our states, or it is throughout the world it should be the method. Whenever a pandemic occurs in any place, they should have to close that place. But closing means, I said, that is the, I am underlining that thing. Closing doesn't mean to abandon them or leaving them to death. They should get proper treatment and proper isolation, proper treatment and everything. That is the right, human right. And each and every country should examine that. If the country is so poor, the rich countries and the United Nations, etc., should help to send some doctors or some foods, anything to that place to contain this thing. The whole world should act as one team. That is the most important thing. That is not happening in, usually that is not happening. And our issue, our state's issue, our country's issue, only our country's issue, that thinking is not good. And in India also, I am mentioning that during that lockdown, we are safe at that time. That doesn't mean I am denying the coming of Malayalis to Kerala. Not only Malayalis, there are so many expatriates from Tamil Nadu and they also returned to Tamil Nadu. There are so many expatriates in Karnataka. They also came back to Karnataka at that time. People are moving here and there, from here and fro. They are moving to and fro. And I am explaining the thing what happened in Kerala at that time. I'm not blaming. And we accepted them also. To control the virus, to contain the thing, we have to stop these kind of movements. But it is not practical sometimes. It happens. Kerala, I think the most vast number of expatriates are from Kerala. We have more than 26 lakhs of migrants throughout every part of the world. And during this COVID season, more than 18 lakhs of the Keralites returned to Kerala. And that is not a simple problem, but we managed it. We welcomed them and we give proper treatment to them. In Kerala, the treatment was fully free in government hospitals. Free treatment to everybody, to the expatriates, to the common people and the rich people. Each and every one who were admitted, who are admitting in the government hospital, the treatment is free. From the beginning itself, it was free. And we are giving that things. And for the migrants also, we are giving the same thing. Here we are so many migrant workers in Kerala, in different parts of our country, from Bihar and from other states. And we have a very good project, especially for the migrant workers. We had arranged very good medical camps for the domicile care centers for the COVID first line treatment centers for the, and we supplied free food to all the migrant workers three times. Morning and noon and evening, we supplied very good food, as their wish. Sometimes they are they asked us that they didn't want rice to eat, they want chapati and they want chicken or anything they want. We prepared and supplied to the migrant workers. We are calling them guest workers, not migrant workers. We are calling these workers in our place in Kerala as guest workers, and we are treating them as guests. And we solved that problem also. They were happy at that time in Kerala. And someone caught virus and some others not. And those who caught COVID, we discharged them from the hospital with good help. And I think the death also is very few in among migrant workers. That is not a large number. And we treated them well.
Thank you, ma'am. My colleague Arnab Mukherjee will ask a question directly. Arnab, you're on mute.
Thanks. Thanks, Shira. Thank you very much for this lecture, ma'am. This has been wonderful. I am going to push you a little bit on something that you said, which is very provocative, which is, you know, raising the expenditure on healthcare all the way to 10%. As you know, you would know well, we are only at 1% of GDP. 10 times that amount of money being available, perhaps the problem that we face through COVID is 10 times larger than the kind of problems that we face. And in fact, the world has been hit with something like infectious diseases like this after many, many, many decades. And, you know, I know of universities which have shut down infectious disease departments 10 years ago, because no one thought this would be appearing in this kind of a scale. So if you had to just imagine that you have this 10% of GDP to spend, how do you do it? There are so many ideas today. There are so many debates. At one end, there are people saying, you know, you do more schemes like Ayushman Bharat, which would get the private sector also involved. But that's all sort of focused on, you know, one part of healthcare, where we have seen a lot of help coming in. Is also on the primary side, where, you know, people are needing home isolation. I just wanted to hear your thoughts on how you would think of, you know, not accounting percent by percentage, but, you know, broadly speaking.
Yeah, I'm not blaming central government or anybody, because during this pandemic season, we worked hand in hand. We obeyed every instructions from the central government, and central government also helped us, health department, and we were attending the meeting of the Prime Minister each and every time, Honorable Chief Minister, and me as the Health Minister at that time. We were attending and we were listening carefully what our Prime Minister is saying and insisting us. And we were doing completely according to their instructions. And also they were helping. They were giving the share of the vaccine they are getting, and they were giving the share of the personal protection equipments and the test kits, etc. We didn't even criticize with them that they are not giving Kerala or they are showing partiality. We cannot say so. We give the good share to Kerala also. But I am saying that that is not sufficient. That is the reality, you know. That is not sufficient. For any state, that is not sufficient. And we should have to make it sufficient. That is the thing. We are not blaming. We have to think together. Central government and state government should have to think together. We should have to find a solution for that. nothing else. We should have to live with the infectious virus. We cannot contain or control them properly or completely. One after another, they are coming. The previous day, Spanish flu was there and the smallpox is there. But human beings are very clever, and also our scientific achievements are very great. And scientists find out some kinds of vaccination and prevention method for that. And we are not suffering from the smallpox now. And we eliminated some kind of infectious disease. But it was not an end, you know. And the infectious disease, new infectious disease are coming. New zoonoses are coming. Everything are coming. We have to be cautious on that. We have to get prepared for that. Getting preparation. What is the preparedness? We should have to strengthen our health system to decentralize this thing to the grassroots level, to for early detection and prevention, to help the poor people. For that, we need money. From where we get money? I can say that the share should increase, or the investment should increase from 1% to 2%. That's a reasonable thing. But with 2%, we cannot do anything, you know. That is why I am saying it is not all of a sudden. Gradually, we should have to increase the investment in the public health system. That is the only way to get out of this problem. Is there any other choice to us? We have several projects, several methods, etc. But we are implementing that projects also. But that projects are not sufficient to tackle a great problem. A great, a severe problem, severe threat like the spreading virus, infectious disease. That is too sufficient. Without strengthening the public health system, without decentralizing the power and money to the local self-governments and to the village level, we cannot tackle this kind of great problem. That is why I am saying gradually we should have to invest at least 10% of the domestic this our products, gross domestic product, to health sector, education sector. That is not a wastage of money, you know. If health is okay, everything will be okay. That will increase the working capacity of the poor people, and that will improve the production of our country, and that will get our country help to get our country stable and to collect more money or collect more revenue out of that. But without the health, all the people are ailing with this kind of diseases, and they are not proper, they have no proper health to work. What is the fate of the future? What is the fate of the country? What will be the future? That is the threatening thing, you know. And investing 10% in the health sector, that is not a wastage of money. And any government who are thinking to tackle this kind of problem, to save human life or save our country, should think about that. That is the thing. I am not blaming, I am not asking next year central government should invest 10%. Central government is also facing several difficulties during the pandemic. They have to shoulder the burden of the whole country. We have to speak about our state only. And the central government should have to shoulder the burden of the whole country. And they are also facing difficulties, but the way to get out of this difficulty is to invest more money in the public health sector, nothing else.
Thank you, ma'am. We'll go on. I have last three questions. So we'll,
okay.
And then we can stop. I know that you've had a long day full of meetings, but one is from my colleague, Bhasita, who's with our department. She says, considering that healthcare workers are at the forefront of any health-related fight, how is the government planning to retain the supply chain of healthcare workers? Has there been any changes in the existing training and development, and you know, how are you managing this constant you know, workforce of doctors and nurses and so on? Particularly,
I have no problem.
And for future pandemics, you know, if
yeah, we have no proper human resource with us, you know. When I became the health minister in 2016, when I examined our staff pattern, is of 1961 staff pattern. We have to promote, or we have to appoint more staffs in health sector. And our honorable chief minister and finance minister helped us very much. And our government created more than 14,000 new staffs for the health sector. I think the major share goes to medical colleges to get the nod from the center or the, from the medical commission to get the NOC for the medical colleges. We utilized that major share of the newly created staffs to medical colleges. And we got more staffs in primary health center. Instead of one doctor, we appointed three doctors in primary health center. That is family health center, I mentioned previously. And the functioning of the primary health center, we extended to the evening section also. 2 to 6 also, there is a doctor in our family health center nowadays. That helped the poor people very much. But the human resource is not sufficient. When the pandemic occurred, and the number of people admitted in the hospitals increased all of a sudden, again, our role capacity became exhausted. And at that time, government allowed us to appoint the sufficient staffs in contract basis, and we appointed thousands of people in contract basis. We also declared a COVID brigade to register in that COVID brigade who are willing to work with the pandemic. Thousands of youths applied in that COVID brigade, and we utilized that doctors, nurses, and paramedical staffs, and even volunteers. They are not medical graduates or they didn't get an education like that, but so many people decided to become volunteers to work with the pandemic. And we utilized them to establish the COVID first line and second line treatment centers, domiciliary care centers, etc. And even in the community kitchen, we declared so many social welfare measures. We supplied the social welfare pensions. We opened community kitchens and supplied cooked food to each and every houses, which was affected by pandemic at that time. And it is continuing now also. We supplied food kits, etc. That is social welfare measures. And the volunteers worked on that sector also. And that way, we find an answer to the scarcity of human resource, and also we give some relief to the existing workers. But they are tired, they are working hard, and we give some offs when we get some contract workers from the field. We can give some offs of time to them, and they are taking rest at that time. And that way we are managing the thing and we are making them fresh, and training also each and every time. We are modifying the training method, and the situation is changing day by day. And all the places, I think we have to adopt new methods, new policies, new changes. The virus is changing its behavior, and we have also to adopt new policies. Nowadays also, we are adopting new policies. Throughout the world, the healthcare workers and system and the government should adopt new policy. The previous policy will not match or should not match with the new things. And we should have to find out new training method, new policy, new testing method, etc., proper time. That is the reasonability. We should have to act reasonably. Without any hesitation, we have to take proper decisions at proper time. And we are doing that thing. That way we are managing the situation.
Thank you, ma'am. I request my colleague, Dr. Alan, to ask you a question. Alan is works in the healthcare sector. So, Alan, please come on.
So, hello, ma'am. And so honestly, I'd like to appreciate the kind of expansive lecture that you've given us. And it's been truly exemplary in terms of your understanding of the situation, the public health impact, and also the evolution of healthcare, as you were speaking about the kind of sustained efforts in the health cadres in the state of Kerala. So most of the states in terms of South India were actually looking at shortages in terms of oxygen, et cetera. It was quite a positive and an advantage factor that most of your medical colleges had their own oxygen plant, which was actually a absolutely important kind of instruction at this stage. So I would like you to kind of point out about the plan to actually expand your oxygen capacity. Was that actually planned or it just happened by accident?
Thank you, Mr. Allen. It was a pre-planned work. I told you during my speech, I put that point also that even in the first wave, that during that first wave itself, we started thinking about oxygen supply. At that time, we have only one of our hospitals have its own oxygen plant. One Taluka hospital had its own oxygen plant at that time. And we had only one oxygen producing plant in government sector, that is in Palakkad district, and that is a small scale production. At that time, we conducted a very good meeting with the health ministry and that industries ministry with the instruction from chief minister. I and industries minister sit together with our secretaries. And at that meeting, I raised the thing of the importance of oxygen supply. And I asked the industries, I appealed industries minister to start oxygen production plant in Palakkad district and to produce more oxygen from that plant. Then we started a plant, one more plant at that time, and that became a great blessing during the second wave. And they started producing oxygen from that. And other than that, we also supplied or invested some money in district hospitals and medical colleges to build their own oxygen plant. We should have to expend the expenditure come to 2 lakhs or 4 lakhs for the medical colleges to start an oxygen plant for them. And for Taluka hospitals, we can say that not 2 lakhs, 1 crore or 2 crore for the medical colleges, and from 15 to 50 lakhs for the small hospitals. With that money, they can build an oxygen plant. And we supplied some money for that, and all the hospitals started making oxygen plant of their own. Some of them is finished and commissioned, and they are getting oxygen from that. Other work is going on. And other than that, the medical colleges started to get oxygen supply to each and every bed. And they through the pipeline, they were supplying oxygen to each and every bed. And it is a contest, we can say like that. They were contesting between each other and reporting to me that we finished 100 beds with the oxygen supply, and we started oxygen supply for 150 beds, etc. And they contested each other, a socialist contest. And with that spirit, they built some oxygen supply in each and every hospitals, and that also helped us very much during the season. And also we have a war room where the Honorable Chief Minister established a war room during the second wave to examine the oxygen supply throughout the state. And if anyone can call to the war room if they have the scarcity of oxygen in their hospitals, at once our truck will go there, started going there and supply oxygen there. Because of that, war rooms are there in the district center also. And because of that arrangement, no hospitals felt complete scarcity of oxygen. They are getting oxygen in the proper time. And we are also have some buffer stock in each and we are testing whether there is a buffer stock of oxygen with us. And we are maintaining that thing also. And that way, we supplied oxygen properly in our state. It is not happened in one day, but it is a preparedness, pre-preparedness, and hard work during these days.
Okay, ma'am. Yeah. All right. So it's quite interesting to note these insights. Thank you.
Thank you.
This is absolutely the last question. I hope you don't mind another 2 minutes. This is my colleague, Mahasini Bhalla. She wants to ask, what is the biggest stumbling block in providing care relief for grassroots level people that you during the pandemic? I mean, and continue to face.
To educate the people, you mean?
No, how did you provide relief to people at the grassroots, the poor, in the remote
that area? That is what I said about the decentralized planning and humanitarian approach of the government. We examined, we have very good volunteers in the grassroots level, and we insisted the volunteers to visit each and every houses to examine whether they are starving or whether they are facing any kind of difficulties. And the pandemic had upturned everything, you know, people cannot go out for work and they are not getting money properly. and the shops are closed and they are getting the eatables even if they have money with them. And we have to solve many problems like that. And each and every local self-government, each panchayat president and each ward members to act well. And they were the rulers of their place. And they should have to keep in contact with the poor people. And the volunteers also helped us to do that. And we had opened the community kitchens in each and every park. And the people supplied us. We got some donations from the rich people and some companies, etc. They were helping us, actually. And with that money, we bought the eatables, rice and pulses, etc. And cooked very good foods and supplied to the poor people. And even food kit too, without cooking, we are supplying rice and pulses, raw material things to the houses. And also in health part, we are giving each and every medicines and CD medicines, etc. proper time. And we are examining whether they are consuming that that medicine, taking that medicine or not. And we are examining each and every part. Yet we solved most of the problem, but yet there are some difficulties because the poor people, they are suffering to remit the loans or taxes of the loans, etc. Most of them took loans from banks and the bankers are coming to take over their property and everything. And they are worried about that. We declared some moratorium on the loans. Our Honorable Chief Minister declared this moratorium, but it is not a problem to the end. It is urgent need. We can declare moratorium, but we should have to help the poor people. Now we are thinking in future, how can we tackle the problem? That is why I am saying the small scale things. In villages, we should have to increase the production. Among these difficulties, there are some opportunities also. People, all the people came out of the cities and they think that villages are more safe and they are coming to villages staying there. They should have to work. They should have to increase the agricultural products. They can work in their land, etc. We are promoting them to work on their lands and improve agricultural sector and small scale things, keeping the COVID protocol, wearing masks, etc. They can work. They can do something. Now we are listening to that part and we should have to make them earning members again and to tackle this kind of problems also. And it is a difficult thing, but we have no other choice, but we have to act. We are acting on that also. And future, we should have some opportunities out of this pandemic. We should have to utilize that opportunities. And the technologies also in each and every village become IT sufficient thing, you know. And the education, it is through electronic system, online education. And each and every houses, we are supplying the mobile phones for the online education and teaching how to use it and teaching the difficulties also. And the mobile phone itself is a friend and also an enemy to the student. And some the bad things are also coming, the games, etc., you know, some student are committing suicide out of this kind of horrible games. We don't know whether it is due to the game or not, but it is not a good thing that. And we are insisting parents to examine your children thoroughly, whether they are using it for the study or they are playing other things in the mobile. But the fact is that the technology came down to the village itself, the new technology. And we are giving free network to each and every villagers through our CAFON project. We are giving proper network to the village. And that is a development, you know. That is a new development. And that is an opportunity people got from the pandemic. There are some opportunities also, and there are some hardships also. We should utilize the opportunities, and we should prevent or tackle these difficulties. That lesson we learned from the pandemic.
Thanks a lot, ma'am. I think you have another meeting coming up. I've been getting messages from your team saying that please conclude. She needs to go somewhere else. Thank you so much for sparing your time. It has been wonderful listening to you. You covered a large ground with a great amount of candidness because you sort of when things were not working. You did admit that it did not work. There was no blame game. It was a very, very interesting talk, and we have a lot of takeaway for this. Thanks for readily accepting to come and grace this occasion. And we hope we will be able to get you onto the campus at some point in time when travel restrictions are removed. Thank you.
Definitely. Definitely, Professor. I will be there once. I want to visit your campus. And thank you very much for helping Kerala previous day said that. And thanks for inviting me to your great conference and this webinar. And I didn't think I explained everything smoothly or as your wish, but I tried to explain my experience during these experiences, I was explaining. And thank you, everybody who are listening to me. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.